Our hearts have been warmed to our brothers in communist lands as we have read of their experiences in the Watchtower and the Yearbook. Now you will be thrilled to hear further news from behind the Iron Curtain to learn how Jehovah's will is coming to pass there also. To speak to us on this subject is Brother A. Ruteman, a member of the Swiss Bethel family and a full-time servant for the past 27 years. Brother Ruteman.
By Jehovah's undeserved kindness, it is my privilege and joy to convey to you the warm Christian love and the greetings from over 100,000 brothers and people of goodwill in countries behind the Iron Curtain, namely Soviet Russia, Poland, Czechoslovakia, Hungary, Romania, Bulgaria, and Albania. They have been kept informed about the preparations for this convention, and their prayers, together with ours, have ascended to Jehovah for the success of this assembly. And now they are in spirit with us, so that, despite the Iron Curtain, our vision is that of one theocratic nation, of one new world society, fully united under Christ, the Right Shepherd, speaking the same pure language and singing in unison the praises of the Most High. Generally, the situation as regards the Lord's people in these countries has become more difficult again in the course of the last 12 months. We will now consider some of them individually. Romania. The 1958 yearbook mentions a split that was caused by someone amongst God's people in Romania. I am pleased to be able to tell this convention that the situation has gradually improved in the course of this service year, and that there is a very satisfactory increase of publishers. The kingdom message is being preached extensively in Romania. Nearly 200 of our brothers are in prisons and camps. Despite this oppression, our faithful brothers in Romania show a splendid spirit of cooperation with Jehovah's organization, and we can be proud to have them as our brothers. Hungary. In Hungary, the government started negotiations with our brothers with a view, as they said, to granting us legal status again. However, to accept the conditions of the government would have meant for our brothers to violate their Christian neutrality towards the powers of this world. This they could not do, and therefore had to remain underground. The details about this are recorded in the 1958 yearbook. Seeing that the hundreds of our brothers in labor camps in Hungary were all freed during the uprising of October 1956, the question was whether they would all have to go back to the camps again. We are glad to say that this has not been the case. At present, there are some 30 brothers in prisons and camps in Hungary. Czechoslovakia. The general situation as regards the work is still the same as comprehensively described in the 1958 yearbook. The ingathering work has very well progressed in the course of this year. Jehovah's Witnesses are the only religious movement still forbidden in Czechoslovakia. During the past 2 years, the authorities did not have recourse to mass reprisals as in 1952 and in 1954-55, because they saw it did not lead to the desired result. In April of this year, 7 brothers, all of them faithful under-shepherds, were arrested and are now in prison. It is not yet known what they are charged with, but it is not difficult to guess when we know what the authorities would want Jehovah's Witnesses to do. Our brothers have been told that while their case is being examined, they should have no meetings and should stop all preaching. Seeing that investigations are going on for years, to obey such injunctions would mean to stop witnessing altogether, which our brothers cannot and will not do. Jehovah's Witnesses in Czechoslovakia have made use of every opportunity to preach, be it from house to house or otherwise. They use one or two completely written out sermons, so that if interfered with by the police, they can insist that the complete sermon become a part of the police report. If a court case ensues, the sermon is evidence that the publisher did not engage in, quote, capitalistic incendiary propaganda, unquote, as certain state officials like to claim. We will now hear something about Russia. After the 20th Congress of the Russian Communist Party in February 1956, on which occasion the new Russian leaders denounced Stalin's dictatorship, things improved for a while. A great number of forced labor camps were closed and their inmates freed, among them also a number of our brothers, with the exception of those who had taken the lead in preaching the gospel in the camps. Outside, responsible brothers such as circuit and congregation servants continued to be arrested and tried before Soviet courts. However, they were not given 25 years anymore, but only 6 years. It was also learned then that Russian Bibles could be sent into Russia. In many respects, the lot of the Russian people became a little easier. Well, this improvement is again a thing of the past. Witnesses who are considered as leaders, locally or nationally, if arrested, are sentenced again up to 25 years in a labor camp. As to Bibles, it is useless to send any to brothers in Russia because they are not allowed to keep them. All this opposition and oppression is due to the fact that Jehovah's Witnesses proclaim the eternal rule of the King Christ Jesus as against that of communism. Communism claiming the monopoly of teaching the people, anything else that infringes on that monopoly must be suppressed. We know, of course, that it is the demons that push communism to fight Jehovah's servants, and this all the more as Armageddon is drawing near. Communism, with its false messianic hopes and its tremendous political power, is one of the biggest obstacles the God of this world has placed in the way of the kingdom. I wish to quote now from a report received as follows. As regards Russia, I would like to state that outside that country, one can hardly imagine what efforts the government undertakes in order to wipe off its territory the activity of God's organization. How hard it is for the brothers in Russia to work can be grasped to some extent when it is learned that about 10 members of the communist youth organization watch and spy upon practically every brother. Add to that many a traitorous neighbor, sometimes false brothers, and as a rule an abundance of policemen, court sentences up to 25 years imprisonment or camp, deportation to Siberia, lifelong forced labor, sometimes detention, lasting detention in dark prison cells. All this can happen to a person uttering a few words about the kingdom of God. And yet you will be happy to know that there are today more kingdom publishers in Russia than ever before. Tens of thousands of people in Russia have opened their Bibles again in order to study the truth as published by Jehovah's Witnesses. In Russia, prisoners are transported in exactly the same kind of railroad carriages as those of other travelers, at least from the outside. For inside, the windows of matte glass are provided with crossbars and the compartments with iron doors. In view of the often very long journeys, it is a long way to Siberia, the carriages are fitted with contraptions for sleeping. Every carriage has a little kitchen. Inside the cities of Russia, the prisoners are usually transported in automobiles labeled bread. Despite the many difficulties with which the brothers have to fight, the people of goodwill have a hearing ear. The inhabitants of Russia have a deep longing for liberation. Millions are sighing and crying. In the camps, one meets people of various nationalities, Americans, Japanese, and even Syrians. These have been kept there since the time of World War II. There are hundreds of such people in every camp. Our brothers in the concentration camps made good use of the milder weather that prevailed in Russia in 1956. They had better opportunities than the brothers in so-called freedom. Here are some of my own experiences. In the region of so-and-so, there are central camps for political prisoners. Last year, one of the Russians, spending his 15th year there, accepted the truth. He showed very great courage. He was a great help to me in witnessing. In camp number so and so, we worked as one works from house to house. At certain intervals, we went from barrack witnessing to all the inmates. We usually began as follows. Dear friends, please give us your attention for a minute. We proclaim, the kingdom of God is the only hope of mankind, and it is at the door. This introduction was usually followed by complete silence. All put aside what they were doing. When we did this in the dining room, all of them, though hungry, put aside their spoons and listened attentively to what they were told about God's kingdom. And so we went from one barrack to another. In 1956, a member of the government came to our camp. A meeting was organized in the dining room. There were about 500 present. After the discourse of the government minister, prisoners were allowed to speak on various subjects. My companion, too, was granted permission to speak. He gave a comprehensive and most stirring witness. He also referred to the relationship existing between the government and Jehovah's Witnesses, and finally mentioned the great liberation which will be brought about by Jehovah himself. Out of gratitude for what they had heard, the listeners seized the brother and threw him up into the air. From this moment, all fellow prisoners greeted us in a most friendly way. Shortly after, we were separated from each other and taken to the punishment camp. But the interest remained. A few weeks later, other brothers were brought into the camp and continued the educational work among the goodwill prisoners. Several tens of these became witnesses. All the brothers are of the opinion that once they are in the camp, nothing worse can happen to them. Their working territory is the camp. Here they must be active. The barracks are their personal territory. One Sunday, we organized a public meeting on the playing ground. There were 800 in attendance. Immediately after the close of the meeting, the officials tried to get me, but I disappeared into the crowd. However, they came to the barracks and I was taken to the punishment isolation camp. Here I met the brother who had given the talk in the presence of the government minister. In this punishment section, there were less than 100 prisoners divided into groups. One after another, these groups approached us with the words, "Please come to us too and tell us your hope." A thorough witness followed in each case. The brothers who are treated as political prisoners are glad about this status. They benefit from the international rules for political prisoners and are freed from any physical work. They make the best possible use of their time and work as full-time publishers. We had really good results. There were cases where people of goodwill were zealous publishers after 6 weeks' instruction. So our brothers in the camps are working zealously despite difficult circumstances. They have regular Bible studies. In some places, they also have the theocratic ministry school. In various camps, I met many other brothers. Outside the prisons and camps, conditions have practically remained the same. Everybody sighs and longs for freedom. Very often the brothers have no Bible. When the postman brought one from abroad, the next day a policeman came and confiscated it. Yet our brothers in Russia have all they need as regards spiritual food. Both among the brothers who are free and those who are in prisons and camps, there is the spirit of the first Christians. They are convinced that he that endures to the end is the one that will be saved. The publishers in Russia are fearless. Their love for Jehovah God is boundless. They do not think of abandoning the fight by any means. They know that the work is Jehovah's and that it must go on till the victorious end. The brothers know for whom they maintain their integrity. To suffer for Jehovah is a joy for them. So much from the report received from Russia. Now I feel very happy to have been able to give you this short account about our fellow brothers and their witnessing work behind the Iron Curtain. While the general average increase in publishers for the whole world for the 1957 service year was 10%, as the yearbook showed, that increase was 15% for the Iron Curtain countries separately. results for these countries for this service year are likely to be even better than in 1957. In the seven countries under survey, there were in 1948 21,935 publishers. By 1953, their number had grown to 40,000, and now this year, there is an all-time peak of 85,000 publishers. Also this year, 99,000 celebrated the memorial in these countries, whereof 126 were of the remnant. However, these figures are not complete. If we want to visualize in our minds all of our brothers and people of goodwill in these countries, we must add many thousands more to the figures just quoted. Jehovah and his King know them all, each and every one of them, in the vast communist empire, be it in the European part thereof, or in Vorkuta in the high north, or in Siberia, or anywhere else. It is heart-cheering to see that the harvesting of the people of goodwill is also going on in these countries, and that at such a satisfactory speed, in spite of all the opposition engineered by the devil, who now causes these powers to act as predicted in Psalm 83:4. They have said, "Come and let us wipe them out from being a nation, that the name of Israel may be remembered no more." But divine power will never allow that. And the splendid stand of our fellow witnesses reminds us of the prophetic words spoken by Ezekiel when he said, "Behold, I have made thy face hard against their faces, and thy forehead hard against their forehead. As an adamant, harder than flint, have I made thy forehead. Fear them not, neither be dismayed at their looks." Ezekiel chapter 3, verses 8 and 9. Our brothers have taken these words to heart, and to the people of goodwill in their part of the earth, they are as a hiding place from the wind and a cover from the tempest, as streams of water in a dry place. And now we have yet a surprise for you, a message direct from our brothers in Russia to this convention. They recorded this on tape somewhere in their vast country and gave it to someone who took it out of Russia under extreme difficulties, risking their liberty so that it might be brought to us. By Jehovah's undeserved kindness, it arrived just in time for you to hear it. First, we hear two verses of song number 9 of our new songbook, "Praise the King of Eternity," as sung by a group of brothers in Russia. And now we give you a part of their message to you in Russian.
Дорогие братья и сестры, с связи с тем, что по великой милости нашего Небесного Отца вы собрались сегодня в Международную конвенцию свидетелей Иеговы, мы желаем хотя бы в нескольких словах передать вам краткое сообщение о нашей жизни и деятельности на территории России. Лишь только благодаря Всевышнему Богу Иегове мы можем жить и трудиться. В продолжение периода после окончания Второй мировой войны до настоящего времени прошли мы довольно трудный и тяжелый путь в борьбе за сохранение веры и непорочности в этом старом мире.
Here follows now the complete translation of their message of love to you. Dear brothers and sisters, by the undeserved kindness of our Father, you are assembled there in the great convention of Jehovah's Witnesses. We would like to briefly report something about our life and activity in the territory of Russia. Thanks to the undeserved kindness of Jehovah, we are still living and working. During the whole period of time since the end of World War II, we have gone forward on a hard and difficult road. Together with you, we fight the right fight of faith and keep ourselves unspotted from the old world. Despite all the great difficulties, persecutions, arrests and reprisals, we have experienced many joys. Our joy is this, that many people of goodwill come to knowledge of the truth and submit themselves to the leadership of the right shepherd, Jesus Christ. The activity of Jehovah's Witnesses has now spread to almost all the territories of this vast country. This has come about by the great goodness of Jehovah, who has showered his blessings upon us. We have been privileged to see that no power of this world is able to tear down that which Jehovah builds up. The words of the Apostle Paul in Romans 8, verses 35 to 39, that nothing will be able to separate us from God's love that is in Christ Jesus our Lord, have a wonderful fulfillment here. In the various circumstances of our life, we always go to Jehovah in faith and ask him for strength and help. Please remember us also in your prayers, so that the Spirit of Jehovah, the Spirit of unity and peace and love, may unite us firmly and strongly in the one new world society. 1900 years ago, our Master said, John chapter 4, verse 23, the hour is coming, and it is now when the genuine worshippers will worship the Father with spirit and truth. For indeed, the Father is looking for such kind to worship him. Today, Jehovah's people thus worship him. We rejoice in the activity of the New World Society throughout the earth and in being able to see the uninterrupted increase of God's people and their becoming ever firmer and stronger. This strengthens also our faith in the prophecies of the Bible. Of course, our joy would be even greater if we could be personally present among you at the great spiritual feet of God's people. Unfortunately, this is not yet possible at present. Hoping, however, that we may yet have the joy of assembling ourselves together with you, we send you, dear Brother North, and to all your close co-workers, as well as to the whole assembly of God's people from all countries of the earth, our warm Christian love and greetings. May Jehovah continue to bless you richly for further successful service in this wonderful work, assuring you that we too are determined to keep pace with the New World Society. To conclude this message, we hear now one verse of song number 21 of the 1928 songbook, The Year of Jubilee.
Thank you.
Now our brothers in these countries will want to hear about this assembly, the greatest in the history of the Christian Church, and an event of tremendous importance. And by Jehovah's undeserved kindness, under the rulership of his King, and with the help of the holy angels, we will humbly do what we can to fulfill the desire of their hearts, so that, hearing of the wonderful things that have happened here, they may, more than ever, feel one with Jehovah's nation earthwide, and that we may all together, this side and that side of the Iron Curtain, across all the barriers of this old divided world, sing the praises of Jehovah and his King as never before. I am sure that you want your brothers and fellow witnesses in these countries to know how much you love them, and that you will always remember them and our connections with them in your prayers till the great and victorious day of Armageddon. So I shall be extremely happy to convey your message of love to them. Will you commission me to do so? Thank you.